Well, now we're at the point in our service where we have a chance to come together with and in our confession of sins. Some of you may have a copy of this at home. You may have it committed to memory, but we also will have it. But we have also closed our eyes and pretended not to see the injustices, the racism, and the evil which pervades our everyday lives. We have shut our ears and pretended not to hear the cries for liberation, which comes from the lips, lives, and hearts of the oppressed, even our own black brothers and sisters. Forgive us, O Lord. Renew our courage and faith, and keep us ever mindful of thy great sacrifices. Hear us, we beseech thee, as we come to you in love and worship, giving your name the praise forevermore. Amen.
Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he sat and dined with his disciples. He took bread and he blessed it and broke it, gave to his disciples and told them to eat all of it. Let us eat together. In like manner, after they had eaten, he took the cup and told them to drink all of it. Let us drink together. He told them, "This do in remembrance of me." And may we never forget what Jesus Christ did for us at Calvary. This meal is for the redeemed. This meal is for the repentant. This meal is for the reconciled. This meal is in honor of he who suffered, bled, and died for us. He told us this do in remembrance of him. We're remembering his person. We're remembering his passion. We're remembering his power. And may we never forget. what Jesus Christ did for us at Calvary. Scriptures further tell us that after they had finished that time together in that upper room, that they got up from the table and they headed down the back stairs of that upper room. And at the landing, at the end of the stairs, they had to cross the River Kidron. The River Kidron was that gully that was cut into the earth where the blood of animal sacrifices was made. And it must have reminded them of what he was about to do for us. And as they wind through the dusty streets of Jerusalem, there are vines everywhere, and Jesus would say to them, I am the true vine. He would say to Peter, stop letting your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. And in a season like we're in, this pandemic season, I want to say to you, chin up. Stop letting your heart be troubled. Believe God. Believe in the Christ who suffered, bled, and died for us. And we are more than conquerors. May God bless us. And so we don't have to sing a somber song. They sang a hymn as they walked through that city. Headed up the Via Dolorosa, where Jesus would carry that cross for you and for me. They sang a somber song. But we are going to sing a song of jubilation because we're on the other side of that awful Friday. Turned out to be a good Friday. Because what Jesus did for us that Friday enables us to do what we are doing every Sunday and every day of the week. So come on, let's gather together and sing a song of fellowship.
Well, he's in the room now. He's in the room. Just tell somebody, he's here. He's here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Surely.
Surely the breath of the Lord is in this place. Can you see the glow of glory? Can you feel this morning breath? He's got a blessing for me.
Lift your hand and say that surely,
surely the breath of the Lord is in this place.
Can't you see?
Can't you see the glow of glory?
Can you feel?
Can you feel this morning breath?
He's got a blessing.
Down. He's walking down the aisle.
Through it.
He's moving.
family, hello friends, and even hello those of you who are not family nor friends. I won't label you as any particular name, but thank you so much for being with us. Thank you so much, those of you who have already started your watch parties. Thank you so much for those of you who've already called your friends, your family, your neighbors, and told them that a blessing is in store for them today, and tell them right here is where it is. We're here every week, thank God, for the technology and the capacity to be able to come to you wherever you are and to share with you and to be in worship with you. And these worship services are designed to enhance our walk, to encourage our witness, and to support our worship. And in so doing, that God's name will be hallowed, that God's kingdom will be realized, and God's will done. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. And I ask you to open your Bibles to Daniel chapter 6, verse 10. We'll only do that one verse in reading, but you'll need to keep your Bible open because we're going to be throughout the sixth chapter. For his bloodshed. For your word hath declared that without the shedding of blood, there could be no remission of sins. And he who knew no sin became sin for us. And we are so grateful. Thank you for so great a salvation. Thank you for forgiveness. Thank you for mercy. Thank you for grace. Thank you for everlasting life. And Lord, as we come today to look into your word together, we ask that you would open now our blinded eyes that we might behold your wondrous truths. And we ask thee, O God, in the name of Jesus, that you would make clear your word to us, that we will not be hearers only, but doers. We bless your name today, O God. Thank you. In Jesus' name we thank you. Amen. Daniel chapter 6, there is this one verse I want to read, because if I start reading the previous verses, the verses prior to it, it'll take some time, but it'll make me shout the whole time through. So I ask you to just come with me at verse 10, and I'm reading from the King James translation. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows opened in his chamber toward Jerusalem. He kneeled upon his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime. I want to put a tag on this text. Don't mess with my prayer time. Don't mess with my prayer time. You may mess with almost virtually anything else, but my prayer time, my privilege to pray, my prayer time, the time that I commune with God, my prayer time, don't mess with it. The first three chapters of the book of Daniel set before us the basic principles for living the Christian life, for living for God in an alien and hostile world. Daniel and his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, torn away from the comforts and shelter of home and set down in a foreign land and under tremendous pressure to compromise and to conform. But they refused to let the world pour them nor squeeze them into its mold. This chapter, chapter 6, records the sixth of six conflicts between man and God found in the book of Daniel. Chapter 1, there is the issue of diet. Chapter 2, there is the issue of dream. Chapter 3, there is the issue of dedication. Chapter 4, there is the issue of deference. Chapter 5, there is the issue of depravity.
And here in chapter 6, there is the issue of decrees and dominion, man's law and the king's treat of lions versus consistent faith and God's protection. Oh, it's going to be tight because it's right. Because the book of Daniel literally can be broken down into two parts. One part largely historical and the other largely prophetical. In the original, original written language, there are two languages, Aramaic and Hebrew. Chapters 1 through 6, let me bring you up to where we are. You have Daniel and his personal friends, and we are offered a key thought concerning personal victory. Is that in chapters 1, 2, and 3, there will be times of testing. They were tested concerning their walk in chapter 1, the challenge of a believer's walk. In chapter 2, there is the challenge of a believer's witness. In chapter 3, there is the challenge of a believer's worship. Let me back up and slow down, because when we talk about the issue or the challenge of a believer's walk, there was this matter of the king's meat, dealing with diet. In chapter 2, when we talk about the challenge of a believer's witness, there was the dilemma of the king's dream, determination. In chapter 3, the challenge of a believer's worship, there are the implications of the king's image, devotion. And you know those three conscientious objectors will tell you early on, we can't bend, we can't bow, and we just probably ought to be a witness to let you know that our God is able, but if not, we won't bend, we won't bow to your oblias. And so there will be times of testings for the believer, but in chapters 4, 5, and 6, there will be times of triumph, the triumph of truth. In chapters 4 and 5, resulting in the conversion of Nebuchadnezzar in chapter 4, and resulting in the condemnation of Belshazzar in chapter 5. And then not only are there times of triumph, but there also be the triumph of truth, and then the triumph of trust. And that's where we are in the lion's den as we journey through this chapter. Several important lessons just leap off the page in this passage, and they'll surface for you today. Number one, you will seldom get what you deserve from people, so don't expect it. Good lesson, huh? Number two, you will always get what is best from God, so don't doubt it. Don't expect what you expect from man. Don't doubt what God offers. Don't doubt. But then thirdly, your ability to handle both expectations and doubt is directly related to the consistency of your walk with the Lord. In the book of Daniel, chapter 6, it is recorded that after Cyrus the Persian had conquered Babylon from Belshazzar, he went on to conquer other countries and other territories of the world. As a result of his leaving the Babylonian locale, Darius, who is believed to have been one of the high military commanders under Cyrus, obtained the throne as king. Darius was now over the kingdom Babylon. Prophecy had been fulfilled here because the Babylonian head of gold had been replaced by the silver arms of the Medes and the Persians. Soon after Darius took the throne as king, he began to reorganize his kingdom into 120 provinces, what we would call states. He did that to ensure that there would be no damage done to him. And over each province or over each state, he appointed a satrap. Now, a satrap is a prince or a governor, a subordinate ruler. And over those 120 satraps, Darius appointed three presidents. They were to be under the control, the direct control of the king. They also were to be directly over the 120 satraps. Their responsibility was to oversee the whole affairs of the government. They were to see to it that the satraps did no damage to the king. They were to see to it that there were no embezzlements of governmental finances. They were to watch the books. They were to keep the books balanced. But they're not only over the 120 satraps that were there, the three presidents. Over two of the presidents, one was selected to be over them all. And you're right. That one that was chosen was Daniel. That then meant that to Daniel, they all had to report. To Daniel, they all had to obey. Yes, to Daniel, they had to give account. Daniel was preferred over the 120 satraps and above the other two presidents because the Bible says an excellent spirit, verse 3, was found in him. Are you traveling with me? This word excellent in the Hebrew is the word satir. It's really yetir. Some say set, but whether you're reading Aramaic or Hebrew, let's for the sake of being together, yetir. Yetir means preeminent. Yetir means very exceeding. And so the word excellent always betokens preeminence, majestic, over, above, very, beyond, surpassing, far more exceeding. So then to say that Daniel had an excellent spirit being found in him, that then means that his spirit was preeminent, majestic, over, above, beyond, very surpassing, and far more exceeding than the 120 satraps and the other two presidents. Daniel was worthy of such endowment because he was a man of integrity. Daniel was head of state because he led a noble, pure, and steadfast life. There was a specialness about Daniel. There was a Godwardness about this man, Daniel, this so noble statesman. There was a charismatic grace about Daniel, and nowhere is there mentioned a flaw about his life nor his attitude. Now, recognizing the fact that the Bible always exposes the positives and the negatives of its, the successes and the failures of its heroes, would it surprise you to know that even though the Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, no sin, no guile, no blemish, and no fault is recorded about Daniel? An excellent spirit was found in this man, Daniel. The Spirit of God was at work in the life of this man. And even though Daniel was now at the writing of this text or at the account of this story, he's in his 80s or his 90s. He's up in the years. He still was not cantankerous and grouchy. When you are doing what God called you to do, what God wants you to do, you can expect to be the object of the green-eyed twin sin monster envy and jealousy on the part of peers, as well as pessimists. So then with Daniel in leadership, this is really what that meant. There was no hope for fraud. There was no chance for looting. There was no chance for raking off the top or skimming off the bottom, shaving some off, or what we call in the big world, embezzlement, if you will. No. Not with Daniel at the helm. No room for foul play either. There was no underhanded opportunities. Not with Daniel at the helm. Because Daniel kept a close eye on the governmental affairs of King Darius. Now, because of his integrity, Daniel became the victim of the dirty deuce, envy and jealousy. And you've got to be mindful of something here. And that is the fact that envy and jealousy always hates the excellency to which it can never obtain. So the Bible says that the presidents and the princes sought to find occasion against Daniel concerning the kingdom. Daniel, y'all, became the target of the 122. Daniel became the object of an unofficial governmental investigation. They sought to find some reason to charge Daniel with some wrongdoing. They made themselves to be the detectives. They made themselves to be the private eyes. They made themselves to be licensed and given permission to do the digging and the prying and the looking in Daniel's past and to paying off informants, if you will. Let your mind go to what they do when they want to interrogate, when they want to investigate, when they want to instigate, when they want to incarcerate. Hold up. They couldn't find nothing nowhere on Daniel. And notice that the Bible doesn't say he was faultless or that he was perfect or that he was flawless. It does say that he was faithful. Is there enough evidence to convict you of being faithful? Is there enough evidence to convict you of being who God called you to be? A cut above, beneath? Huh? Is there enough evidence to convict you of being a Christian? I'm asking you, and I'm not asking you to just look in here and say, I'm asking you to look within and answer this question. If you were on trial today for being a Christian, if you were on trial today for being faithful, if you were on trial today, would there be enough evidence to convict you if you were on trial today for being a prayer? And I'm not talking about a Sunday prayer, because it just might be that you are found guilty of being pious on Sunday, but a contradiction on Monday. Would you be found inconsistent with a new creation, where all things are passed away? Behold, all things are become new. We should so live as never to bring dishonor to the name of Jesus. And y'all, I want you to notice this text. because with all of their subtle and secret and clandestine cryptic secret scrutiny, all they found was that Daniel was faithful. Daniel was faithful daily. Daniel was fearless daily. Daniel had fellowship with God daily. Daniel was tested daily and tried daily and tempted daily, yet daily he was triumphant. Christians today face many temptations to compromise and to conform. And it often appears that the safest course is to go along, to get along with the crowd. But I want to announce to you today that the only real safe place is in the will of God. Daniel was a man who would rather die obeying God's word than live outside God's will. Look at the text again, because they are probing into Daniel's background. They're Googling, tweeting, texting. And you know what? What did they find? Here's what they came up with. And I got the investigation report. No shady dealings anywhere. Every judgment that he made, every deed that he did, every mandate that he signed, every order he gave was found to be flawless and faultless. An excellent spirit, I tell you. Hey, I have the report right here. This is what they found. No taking for personal gain anywhere. No false or forced balances anywhere. No short measures anywhere. No hidden leaves. Not one dirty footprint. Not one tangled thread anywhere. Not a rip, not a tangle. Not one question mark anywhere. Only periods and exclamation points. That's all they found. Oh, they searched. Oh, they investigated. Oh, they looked into his boyhood. Oh, they looked into his background. Oh, they looked among his brethren. They found nothing. There was nothing, I tell you, anywhere, for Daniel was above bribery. Daniel was impeccable. Daniel was incorruptible. That's all they found. Faithful, dependent, devoted, courageous, committed, an excellent spirit. What a compliment, y'all. What a compliment to the integrity and the honesty of this stately old man, Daniel. And I told you, Daniel's prominence and Daniel's uprightness, Daniel's specialness accounted for the entire cabinet's hatred of him except Darius. Darius, the king, was fond of Daniel. Darius, the king, was proud of Daniel. Darius, the king, had total confidence in Daniel. Yeah, but you know what I've discovered? Is that whenever a man, a woman of God is lifted above the secular and the mundane, whenever a man or a woman of God is lifted to a place of prominence above mediocrity, making a difference, being a game changer for the good, even in these pandemics, you better be careful. And I've discovered something else too. And that is that whenever you try to live upright, try to do what's right, you better be careful. I've lived long enough now to know that when you try to live right, somebody is going to seek to tear you down. Somebody is going to seek to destroy you. Could be a family member, could be a fellowship member, could be somebody who really don't know you. I've lived long enough now to know that men can cry when you cry, but they cannot rejoice when you rejoice. Whenever you are exalted and whenever you try to live right, you're going to be dogged and hounded and trailed and followed by envy and jealousy. You're going to be number one on Satan's hit list. That 24/7, there will be this APB out on you. Oh, Ports Bulletin, won't it? So that's why envy burned in the hearts of these two presidents and 120 governors or satraps, if you will, the 120 princes, the whole cabinet. They knew that Daniel was honest and upright. They knew that there was no chance for illicit gratuities, no kickbacks, nothing under the table, no chance for swindling or embezzlements. Not while Daniel was at the helm. Not while Daniel is over the government. They were looking for gain by grasp, but they couldn't do it while Daniel was in charge. You see, Darius knew what he was up against when he came and rose to power. That is why he reorganized his whole cabinet structure. So the only recourse of these presidents and these governors was to try to do away with Daniel, this old sedate and stately and godly man. But you know what? I've also discovered in the case of the godly and the pagans, the only answer in the mind of the pagan as it relates to the saint of God, the child of God, is to sever their heads off, crucify them, burn them at the stake, drown them in water, beat them, throw them in the dungeon, let them rot, stone them, cut their tongues out. Hang them high, drop them low, don't matter, just destroy them. For that's the only ghost of a chance that the unsaved have to even remotely handle the children of God. So Daniel's enemies couldn't find anything on him, so they turned elsewhere. And it is likely that some expert attorney from the Babylonian Bar Association, who was remarkably acquainted with the laws of the Medes and Persians, said, "Now, hold on, fellas. I may be on to something here. We're not gonna find anything on Daniel with all of this paperwork. We're not gonna find anything on Daniel with all this pencil pushing, with all of this interviewing, with all of these interviews. No, we're gonna have to look elsewhere." And no doubt, he says, "I just had a light to go off." Watch him. He says, "I remember something about Daniel. He's not such a bad guy after all, because he's very faithful. He's faithful in prayer. He's faithful. He's faithful in his position. He's faithful. He's faithful with the use of power. He's faithful. But I think what we can get him on is this faithfulness in prayer to his God. Listen at him. I know this will work because I've noticed that through all of our genuflections and in all of our ceremonies, all of our incense burning and all of our chants and incantations, I've noticed something about all of our rituals going on, all of our adoration of our idol gods. I've noticed that Daniel never participates. Daniel never takes part in none of our stuff. See, while we're doing our thing, Daniel always only talks to somebody he calls Jehovah. And I've noticed that he frequently communicates with Jehovah. 3 times a day, he's up in the morning. He's up at noontime. Even in the evening, he's talking to Jehovah. While we're doing our stuff at our various times throughout the day, he's not hanging with us. And I've noticed that he doesn't participate in none of that other stuff. No lotto, no cash 3, no fantasy 5, no scratch and get broke. I mean, he doesn't even play bango, nor the banjo. He doesn't get involved in Black Cats and Black Fridays, not even Black Peas. He doesn't get involved in none of that stuff. No black magic. He never participates. He doesn't ask what Uncle Sandy says. He doesn't consult the Ouija board. Not Daniel, y'all. He's not talking about no horoscopes. No, I'm a Sagittarius and I'm a Leo and she's a Cleo. That's how I know we are made for each other. Oh, no. I've noticed from Daniel's discussions that he's got a lot of Elohim rhetoric, a lot of Yahweh linguistics. And y'all, I think we're onto something. I think that just may be the key. And so the record is that they made up a decree and eat it. And they made their way to the king with this decree. And they were filled with so much invigorment. They attempted to win the king, which didn't take much because he loved flattery. Oh, Darius loved, it is so known of him. It is known historically about him. He loves flattery. And so they got a lot of flattery for him. Listen at their flattery. Listen at their smooth, suave speech. Verse 6. Chapter 6, verse 6. Look at it. King Darius, live forever. Watch him. Watch the lie. All of the presidents and all of the governors and all of the princes and all of the counselors and all of the captains, I mean everybody, you know, most of those folk, they had no clue that none of this was going down. This was rigged up by those two presidents who couldn't get over, and he sold it to those 120 governors. I doubt if the other folk down that ladder ever knew anything about it. But they said to him, King Darius, live forever. All of us have come together. And we tell you what we want to do. We're going to make you God with a little g. for a whole month. Hang on, King, because we've already decided it. We elected you the king of the universe. And all of the subjects of this realm, we're going to genuflect. Oh, la, 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 la. We are going to bow down before you for 30 days. You're going to be our little G God. For 30 days, for 30 days, you're going to be infinite and infallible. You're going to be divine for 30 days. Listen to them. Listen to them. They're tickling his ego and they really know what they're doing. They're toying with his ego. They know what they're doing. King Darius, live forever. For 30 days, you're going to be deified. These administrators, watch them now. Y'all listen. Whew. When I tell y'all to pray for the administrations, when I tell you to pray for the cabinets, I ain't just talking about for president and vice president. Mm-mm. Pray for the cabinets, because those folk in Congress will come up with some crazy stuff. Those folk in the legislature will come up with some stuff. Those folk will come up with some stuff and then ship it down to the satraps, the governors. And we, you know, you got one in Florida, I'm telling you, he's just waiting for something that's backwards. Listen, these administrators were very clever in the plot they conceived. And I tell you the way they presented it. See, they knew that Darius wanted to unify the kingdom and as quickly as possible transform the defeated Babylonians into loyal Persians. What better way? What better way than to focus on the great king himself and make him not just the supreme leader, but the only little G God for an entire month. To emphasize the importance of this law, the officers requested the ultimate sentence. Anyone who didn't obey it would be thrown into a den of lions. Notice the plurality of it. I know when you see pictures, there's this one lion. No, it is scripturally lions, a plural. Of course, their flattery fed the king's pride, and he quickly agreed with them. Had the law written out and signed it. And once it was signed, the law could not be changed or nullified. Look at verse 8. Look at verse 12. Look at verse 15. Look at Esther chapter 1, verse 19. And y'all, the king was so flattered.
I like it. Thank you all very much. This is such an honor. This is such an honor.
He was so flattered that without thinking, and without consulting his number one man, where is Daniel anyway? Where is Daniel? Daniel doesn't know about this concoction. And he is so, Darius is so, until he just falls for it. And y'all, that tells me something else here. As you better be careful when people start playing around with your vanity, when people start tickling your fancy, patting you on the back as if they're trying to make you cough up something. Oh, wrong motives. You better be careful, cause your destruction is round the corner. Satan always serves you some delicacy, some dessert, something delicious, and then he serves you that which is destructive. And I hear you asking the question, what's so bad about the signing of this document? I already told you, but I'm gonna tell you again, is that with the signing of this decree, with the signing of this edict, that meant giving true religion a vacation. That meant giving true religion a leave of absence, not just a social distance. That meant giving true religion a sabbatical, if you will. And let me just stop off here one more time to tell you that too many of us have put our daily devotion on hold. Too many of us have closed our prayer closet and have put prayer, we put our entire prayer life on leave. Too many of us have put our worship on wait. Wait for what? Wait till the church, wait till we start having church again in the building. Put our worship on wait. Wait for what? Wait until I hear tell that pastor's not on that Joseph series, and he's not on that Holy Spirit series, and he's not, well, keep waiting, because I'm on the prayer series. I'm talking about pandemic praying. I'm talking about how to pray when you are exiled from the building. I'm talking about praying when you don't feel like it. Praying when you think you can't. Too many of us have become early retirees from regular worship, and we're unemployed from the various ministries. Too many believers have bombed Bible study, postponed prayer, on a Sunday school sabbatical, discontinued daily devotion, and have canceled consecration and communion. I ain't driving way over there to get no cup of juice, and I don't think it's right to use juice. I don't think it's right to use real wine. Yeah, I got some wine, but I don't think it's right to eat. No. Here in the text, cancellation is just for 30 days. And so tickled to death, he was Darius. And yet not being aware that this decree was the devil's dark and devious device to destroy the devoted servant of God, Daniel, the king, verse 9, signed it. Now you see why I wanted to just read verse 10, because I could teach you down through those earlier verses. This decree meant that for 30 days, all connections between the throne of grace and mercy and helpless, hurting and hungry, thirsty, trying and dying men and women was completely cut off. And somebody, that didn't obey would be thrown in the lion's den. That is what you call the ultimate death in their culture. No, they weren't going to let you be a murderer and then get to live for 10 years before probation and call that justice. Oh, come back. I can't always stay away from that craziness. No doubt Darius nor these dudes had heard nor read Nebuchadnezzar's recorded praise report in Daniel chapter 4. Maybe you haven't either. You ought to read it. So I think if they had read Neb's praise report in Daniel chapter 4, they may would have rethunk their action, their behavior here in chapter 6. Now, here's the key to the whole thing. The law of the Medes and Persians was such that once a document had been signed, I'm gonna say it again, that according to the law of the Medes and Persians, is once a document, an edict, A decree of this nature had been signed, constructed, signed, sealed. It could never be altered before the expiration date. When Daniel finds out about this edict, and the king hears Daniel's story, Darius can't even veto, because this, according to the laws of the Medes and Persians, cannot be altered. This royal edict could not be reversed. And so once it was signed, even though after Darius hears about this devious device, and then hears Daniel's story. I told you, Darius loved, he loved Daniel. Darius trusted Daniel. Darius had highest respect of Daniel. And I'm glad he did. But he could not tear up that document. He could not unsign his name on it. He had to carry it through. And anybody that violates that decree, anybody that prays to somebody else other than Darius, anybody that bows to anybody else other than Darius, anybody else that receives your genuflections, you will be thrown in the lion's den. What a hostile climate. But when the news hits the street that the king has signed such a decree, you know, some concerned Hebrews ran to Daniel, tried to get Daniel to pack a few things and leave town for 30 days. There's always somebody who don't mean no harm when there's trouble around, when the enemy is doing his thing. There's always somebody who tries to get the one that makes the difference to quit. Let me park there for a minute, because I have not understood this yet. It's why, if you are the troublemaker and I'm the peacemaker, why should I quit? If you the one that do what you got no business doing and is tearing this stuff up, why should I say, I ain't got time for you jive time people. I don't have to put up with this. I don't have to put up with this. If I'm right, why am I the one supposed to, child, if I was you, why are you going to take advice from somebody else who ain't doing nothing? See, that's why I don't sing. That's why I don't usher. That's why I don't even go to church no more. That's why. And that's what they did. They ran to Daniel and they said, "Bud, I know you don't want to do it, but we need you. You are our statesman. You are our senior statesman. We need you. We already know what you're going to do concerning this edict. So, for us, why don't you leave town for 30 days? Why don't you leave the ministry? Why don't you quit? I gotta hurry on. Yeah, okay. All right. Always gonna be somebody trying to get you to quit. And then Daniel was much aware of the fact that this sure penalty of death for sticking with God was designed to destroy him. So at the close of chapter 1, you don't want to miss out on understanding Daniel, because at the close of chapter 1, you discover that Daniel was blessed with wisdom, that Daniel was blessed with the weight of influence, and that Daniel was blessed with well-being. But these things are now in jeopardy. Here in chapter 6, while he is behind enemy lines. I love that movie. I love that movie. I love that movie. I started to title this message, Behind Enemy Lines. Yet in spite of the danger, in spite of the stress, notice how Daniel keeps his cool. What do you do when you've been lied on? What do you do when you've been plotted against? Let's see how Daniel stayed cool. Because the question before us today is, through all of this, what could Daniel have done in the midst of this internal envy, jealousy, and strife and hostility? I mean, what do you do? Well, Daniel could have called an assembly of the statesmen and petitioned them and explained before the king the fact that these leaders had concocted this murderous scheme just to get rid of him. But he didn't do that. Or he could have postponed his daily prayer meeting for 30 days, couldn't he? Or he could have surmised that his life was more valuable to his enslaved countrymen. Or he could have left Babylon at prayer time until the storm had passed over. Or he could have closed the window, drawn the curtain, shut the door, stopped up every crevice. Yeah, that's what he could have done. He could have gone along with the crowd. I mean, after all, everybody else was doing it. What is one little compromise? What damage could that do? At the end of his life, keep in mind, he's an old man now, 80, 90 plus. He served God well from his childhood up. Could he not be more useful to God alive rather than eaten by lions? What is going on in Daniel's thought process? Well, I do know Daniel refused to compromise, that Daniel refused to cooperate, that Daniel refused to conform, that Daniel refused to comply. I can do this all day, but I can't. I'm going to Howell Razor. I have to bring this to a close for the day. But watch it. If Daniel had done any of that, it would have ruined his testimony. Oh, it takes courage to prefer your character over your reputation. It takes courage to prefer character over what people gonna say. It takes courage. It takes commitment. What a testimony. He would rather be eaten by man-eaten lions than to miss one prayer meeting. Wow. I think what he was saying, I ain't gonna let nothing mess with my prayer time. I ain't gonna let nobody
mess with my prayer time. And in his behavior to follow, you're going to see how he declares, don't mess with my prayer time. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I know you don't want to stop there, because I don't want to stop there. I may even go head on and do the other half. And since we are virtual, I may just play the other half in the next hour. I hate to leave you like this, but what will it take for you to be so committed to God that if there is cause to threaten your life, your very life, I'm not talking about your comfort. I'm not talking about your commodities. I'm not talking about your car and your cash. I'm talking about your commitment to Christ. At what price do you compromise? At what price do you conform? At what price do you cooperate with the enemy? At what price? Keep your seat. Don't sit there all week for the next week. I just might do the other half. Because you need to know that we ought to get to that place where you will declare, you can mess with my car. You can mess with my cash. You can mess with my comfort. But don't mess with my relationship with my Christ. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this portion of the preached word. Thank you for making verses 1-9 of chapter 6 very clear. Thank you, Lord, that we get the opportunity to look at how Daniel handled conflict, how Daniel handled challenge, how Daniel handled being exiled from the place of his homeland, from his comfort, and even in a strange season, even incarcerated, even in enemy territory, he would not compromise on his relationship with you. Lord, we pray that we will mature to such a level where we won't let a ball game, and we won't let a movie, and we won't let a television series, and we won't let all these other idols, people, possessions, we won't let these other idols rob us of our prayer time. We can't get there without your Spirit. We need the Holy Spirit to aid us and assist us in our prayer life. And we thank you for the partnership. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There may be someone here today who said, I sure would love to have a relationship with God like that. I've never accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. I want to get to know God as my Father. I want to get to know Jesus as my Savior. I want to get to experience and to know the Holy Spirit as my Comforter. And so preacher, would you tell me how to come to know the Lord in a real and personal way? I sure would. I like a little method that's used sometimes around the world. It's very simple. It's the acronym ABC. The A is for acknowledge. Acknowledge what? Acknowledge that I am what God says I am, a sinner. I have missed the mark of God by birth and by practice. And I want to believe that Jesus Christ suffered, bled, and died for my sins. He paid for my sins. Sins past, sins present, sins future. And I want to see. I want to come confessing that I believe, I acknowledge, I am ready for God to father me. If that's you, we're providing you with our phone number to call. Call us and we'll talk you through, or email us and we'll arrange where we can talk to you. We're still, as a church, practicing social distancing. We're not gathering at our church building. We're moving closer back to the building. We have already begun to get some persons who are willing to social distance and obey our guidelines for dealing with coronavirus and other ills in this society. We have a written policy and guideline for those persons who will support the church in gradually getting us back. We started with some persons who will pray. We've started with some persons who will sing. We're not rushing back because it's not time yet, but we're starting with a remnant of praying people. Even as you will continue to pray at home, if you're not a part of the remnant, we're all one family. We're starting with some singing people, not just people who used to sing in the choir, who used to be singing. No, this is a whole brand new motive and mindset of persons immersed in ministry together to be extensions of my pastorate. And we'll continue the wonderful work. When you all see members of our mission and outreach ministry, when you see those persons who labor and co-labor all the time in our pantry, give them a high five for me. Tell them thank you. Yes. And when you see, as we continue to press upon our leaders to reboot the ministries, and you begin to meet in the Zoom room by Zoom school, that's Sunday school, y'all, and the other initiatives that we are using to keep us together as family. Yes, we received a few letters from persons saying, I'm moving my membership to somewhere else. And yes, we received those persons who have united with us, persons who were just surfing the internet and saw how we do things. And there are going to be more of persons coming, and some who will think that their time is up. However God allows, I want you to know that we can't do this without you. We can't do it without your
integrity. We can't do it without your faithfulness. I'm not asking you to do anything that God doesn't want you to do. I'm asking you to partner with me and let's obey him. Let's obey him in serving. Let's obey him in growing. Let's obey him in giving. Let's obey him in our walk. Let's obey him in our witness. Let's obey him in our worship. All right. So if you would take advantage of the phone number, if you'd like to know more about us, if you'd like to know more about our Father, and if you would like to know about more about our church and how we are doing what we're doing, love to see you. Love to see you. Love to hear from you. And because our time is far spent for this worship service, we don't ever want to leave worship without worshiping in its fullness, and giving is an act of worship. So Bible-based, it is time for the offering. I found this envelope. It's the last one I've got. It's not the pink one, but it does the same thing. Listen, we have other ways of being faithful to the ministry, faithful to God. I think of 2 Corinthians chapter 8, where Paul lifts up the Macedonian Christians and says here is this little church, this little beleaguered church, who we didn't expect to be involved in the offering as they have been. He says, but we know how they did it. They gave overboard. They gave above. They gave exceeding abundantly because, he says, they gave themselves to God and to us first. And I think that's all I ask you to do, is to be faithful to God and then be faithful to the church leadership, and things will work out, not only for the church, not only for the community, but for you as the individual Christian, and for those persons who are yet to become Christians. Because all of what we do is for evangelization, to win the lost, and for edification, to build up those of us who are born again. Listen, it's been great worshiping with you today. Y'all know I'm tempted to do it. I tell you what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna promise you the other half of it. Now, we've got parking lot worship, where we're going to celebrate our 23rd church anniversary. And I'm afraid to tell you it's this coming Sunday, because if we have to change it again because of the weather, another half of you going to be concerned about it. So let's plan to enjoy this worship today. And let's plan wherever and however God chooses for us to worship next Sunday, first Sunday, communion Sunday. Get your communion supplies. Thought I had some here, but stop by the church and pick up your communion supplies. Stop by the church and give your tithe, your offerings, your grace gifts. Stop by the church and give your alms. Mm-hmm. And just passing through. They're going to check your temperature. They're not going to hug you, and they're not going to do all of that. We're still doing what we're doing. A, to keep you safe. B, to keep us safe. C, to keep our community safer. Whew. With all of this spiking and all of this going up of deaths and all this going up and going up of testing positives and all of this fear that people have over whether they should take the vaccine or not. I told y'all I took the two shotter. I would have taken the one shotter if the one shotter was what they was offering when the shots was being offered to me. Now, anybody that wants a shot, they're making them available. I used to always want to go over there to the dog track, but now they passing vaccines out like that. You don't have to wait in line. You don't have to stand. You don't have to have an appointment. Just go there. Go there. I want to encourage you. It's better to have it and not need it than to need it and not have it. Hey, listen. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the sweet communion, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us now and forever. Amen.
Are you a member of the Bible-Based Fellowship Church of Temple Terrace who is graduating from high school, college, or a professional program? Is your child moving up to the next grade level? If so, the Education Enhancement Ministry needs your information in preparation for the Drive-By Fanfare Celebration for our 2021 graduates and students on Saturday, June 5th from 11 a.m. to 12 noon. To submit your information, please contact Jamila Gabriel or Petra Roach at the phone numbers listed here and plan to join us as we celebrate our graduates and students on Saturday, June 5th. The Bible-Based Fellowship Church of Temple Terrace, in partnership with Metropolitan Ministries, is sponsoring a hygiene drive. Please make note of the needed items here and bring them in a clear Ziploc bag, sorted by men's, women's, or children's items, and place a label on the bag. You may drop off your donated items Monday through Friday at the church office, or you may bring them with you to the church anniversary parking lot service on April 25th.
Jesus took hold of me, reached down and gave me liberty, drew me out of deep waters. The Lord rescued me from my enemies. My foes, they were too strong for me. comfort in the day of disaster. My master set me free. Jesus rescued me. Jesus rescued me. Jesus rescued me. Jesus rescued me. When I was down and out, oh, Jesus rescued me. Jesus rescued me. Jesus rescued me.
Jesus took hold of me.
Oh, yes, he did.
Reached out, gave me liberty.
Oh, 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 Jesus
took hold of me.
Took hold.
You have been in worship with the Bible-Based Fellowship Church of Temple Terrace. We hope that you have been richly informed and inspired, enlightened and encouraged for such a time as this. Join us as often as your schedule allows and like and share us on your social media platforms. Join us online at www.bbftt.org for church online every Sunday at 8 a.m. and 11 a.m.